Good morning, everybody. I think, I hope everybody can hear me. So thanks for coming to that webinar. I'm going to try to make it in half an hour. I'm going to try to do my best. So I'm going to present today a funny story, a story I really like. So if you've been around conferences in 2019 before the COVID crisis, you probably already heard that story because I was explaining it at, for example, Virus Built-in or BotConf, but I never went public with that presentation, but I really like it, and I think it's a very good case to better understand how cybercrime works and how everything works together. So I've chosen today to go public and present everything. So the goal of this presentation, it's not really about one specific actor. It's more about how this actor evolved in the cybercrime industry. And I'm going to try with different anecdotes I've managed to collect during the investigation. I'm going to try to present different fun stories, like explain a little bit how everything works. Because we have cybercrime is very difficult, to study because we are all doing lots of intel. Sometimes, most of us, we are digging binaries because that's what we have, like incident response cases, and we have binaries. Sometimes you can evolve and have access to a CNC, but even when you have access to a CNC, most of the time, it's not enough to have the big picture of an operation to really understand how this operation works, how many people work behind the panel, what they do, how they make money. Sorry. And things like this. So here I'm gonna try to explain what happened. It's like I was following an actor, and this actor make a huge mistake. Sometimes it's happened. All these threat actors are human beings and they do mistakes. And that one, it was a threat actor, so it's a carder, a guy frauding the bank mainly. So he was discussing with many of his partner. And when you do this kind of operation, like any kind of operation, you need to exchange files, like config files or screenshots or things like this. And that guy didn't want to use a public services to host those files, like most of the threat actors, they use a SendSpace or website like this. But that guy wants to create his own website. And of course, he leaks all his data from his website. So I managed to retrieve everything. And it was a lot of information. So that carder, I'm going to call him Bagzu. That's not his real nickname, but it's a name I'm going to explain later why. But it's a name I found, and I've keep it because it's easier to track the guy. And again, as I said in the beginning, it's always very difficult to have the big picture of an operation. So I'm going to try to be the more right possible, but maybe I've made some mistake and I didn't understand some stuff right, but I'm going to try to do my best. So our guy, Bagzu, it's a guy part of what I'm going to call the fraud industry. So it's all these people who wants any kind of, they use any kind of way to make money. So it's frauding bank, frauding retail shop, any kind of fraud that can bring money. And today it's a huge, huge, huge and successful market. It's it was because the market is changing. I'm going to explain a bit later, but it's some very successful people. We speak about people that managed to steal over millions of euros. So for example, I was discussing with a carder who got arrested last year, who stole half a million euro to the bank, and he said, I'm a small player. Half a million, it's nothing compared to what my other partner can do. So it's really people that can make a lot of money. They are very well organized. It's not one guy working alone in the dark and doing everything himself. Today, it's a whole industry. It's kind of the security industry. You have lots of different products, and it's a market, and you can buy different products. The fraud industry is the same. You have different products. I'm going to explain them a bit later. And you just buy some product around and expect to make profit with them. And it's, yeah, very profitable. And all these people, they are very specialized. In this industry, you see more and more like some people specialized in very small things like packing binaries or sending email or selling certificate for your binaries or selling exploit kits. And all these people are very specialized in small group, and that makes the whole industry very strong. So you don't have like a big group that do a lot of things, but in a bad way. It's a lot of small groups that do small things very well. And they are very strong because it's people all around the world. You have a market in Russia, in China, in South America, in Europe, and they all work together. That makes them very stronger. So it's a very, very successful market. But we observe these days, even this month, that the market is changing, because I'm not saying that the banking Trojan industry and the carding industry is changing, is dying today. It's not the case. We will still have people frauding the bank. Today we see more and more over smartphone, like Android, it's very trendy. But on Windows, we have observed a big shift in almost every major banking Trojan, so like Gozi, Trickbot, they have done that. Gozi, Trickbot, GoodKit, all these big banking Trojan group, now we see that they are switching to ransomware, because ransomware is way easier to use. So you frauding bank, it's kind of, I'm going to explain later, but it's a lot of work. You need to cash out the money, you need to do money laundering, and even having access to very interesting bank account, it's more and more complicated. Ransomware, it's way easier. You have, today on the market, you have a huge pool of pen testers, because it's very easy to, not very easy, but it's kind of easy to become a pen tester today. You have lots of documentation everywhere. So you have a huge pool of pretty good pen testers that they are jobless. So it's very easy to hire those people. In the market, you have those ransomware as the service who appear. So now lots of actors who are frauding the bank, today they just hire a bunch of pen testers, they pay a ransomware as a service, and they make way more money with the ransomware business. It's a shift we are seeing. And Baxu follow that trend too, I'm going to explain later. So Baxu, it's a guy, as I said, he's frauding the bank. He's focused mainly on mostly on the German bank, because that's a bit how the carding market by tradition was working. Because when you fraud the bank, if you want to go big, you need to really understand the different bank on the same country, how that works, how the website looks like, how you can exchange money without getting flagged by the bank. So the carder, most of the time, they focus on a very few countries. They don't fraud worldwide and expect to take money a little bit around. That doesn't work like that. And Baxu is this kind of guy who focuses mostly on Germany. So as I said, I retrieve a lot of data about that guy. From this presentation, I'm going to present what he has done on the business since 2017 until these days. But on the data I've managed to retrieve, I know that this guy is active since at least 2005, so almost 20 years now. And he's there since very long time. He was there before Gozi even exists. He was there before Zeus even exists. He was there before everything. He's a very old-timer guy, probably have a lot of connection, because when you start very early and you continue to grow, you just grow with the same people over the years. So very interesting guy. And what he's doing basically, he's the guy managing a group of partners that fraud the bank. He's kind of a leader that hires a bunch of people who manage a project, and his project is to steal money from the German bank. So I'm going to present what he was doing. So I'm going to try to present the evolution of the guy. So I'm going to start with what he was doing before the end of 2018. It's kind of boring, it's old stuff, so I'm going to go quickly. Before 2018, so what Baxu was doing, he was doing almost everything himself. So he was distributing a first malware. So it's a password stealer, because he needs to steal a password. It's very important when you need to fraud banks, or you need to fraud an Amazon account or eBay. You need password, you need email password and things like that. So he was using Pony, and at the end, Azurult. And those malware are password stealer, but they are also dropper. So he was spreading Pony, and once Pony was infecting a victim, Pony was dropping a second stage malware, which is the modified version of Zeus, called Zeus Action. I think it's Fox IT who give that name. So it's called Zeus Actions, and Zeus Actions will use the traditional mechanism, the web inject, and the VNC and the SOX proxy to manage to have a fraud on the bank. And since 2014, at least, I know he's using a custom Android malware. So it's something he pays somebody to develop in, to develop that malware. And it's something used to bypass any kind of two-factor authentication. So I've worked with Caffeine, so a well-known French researcher specialized in lots of things, but also specialized in exploit kits. And he helps me to find some traces of Baxu. So we catch Baxu. He was a client of Angular exploit kits, who has been taken down some years ago. And after that, he was also client of Rig exploit kit and Fallout exploit kit. And it's very interesting because on those data I've managed to grab, so I saw that Baxu was discussing with Fallout exploit kits the first day, because he switched from Rig exploit kit to Fallout exploit kit. And the first day he moved to Fallout, I managed to retrieve the discussion he has with the Fallout operator. And what he was discussing is that in the past he was working with Rig exploit kit, and apparently the way that Rig exploit kit distribute the exploit kit in the wild, they were using a lot of very weird pornographic websites to distribute the malware. And Baxu explained to the Fallout exploit kit guy that he's running a banking Trojan business, so he needs people with money to fraud them. What Rig was doing was bringing him lots of poor people who doesn't have any money. So Baxu doesn't have any interest to steal $10 to somebody. He wants like good money. So he has to switch to a new product. He moved to Fallout, and Fallout explained him, don't worry, we have good traffic and stuff. We don't spread like this. And Baxu was happy to have like better quality, bots of better quality, like people with more money. It was more interesting for him. They were discussing, and for example, Baxu was buying 1,000 infection. When you buy 1,000 infection to Fallout exploit kit, it's around €1,200. In 2018-19, it was €1,200. You pay 600 before they start spreading the exploit kit, and you pay the rest 600 after the 1,000 infection. It was very interesting to follow that, and that's the kind of challenge that they have to deal with in the cybercrime industry. If you run a banking Trojan, you need people that have money. You cannot just spread randomly and infect random people like some very trending stuff, like spreading a fake Minecraft crack, for example. You're gonna infect young people that doesn't have any money. So when you run a banking Trojan, there is no interest to have those bots. So this kind of challenge that in the cybercrime industry they have to deal with, and that's why you have different competitors in different positions in the market. So he was using exploit kits to drop first Pony and at the end Azeroth. Pony, it was the open source version. Pony, it's a malware that has been open source for years. You can find it everywhere, it costs nothing. So he was using it. The panel was just full of German credential. So very basic, that's just Pony, kind of boring. After Pony, Zeus appeared. So Zeus, he took Zeus leaked in the wild, the source code leaked in the wild. So he grabbed the source code and he paid somebody to maintain the code and make some modification. Because it was until end of 2018, and Zeus was in 2018, it's already a very old bot. And you need to support like new browser like Edge and all the new version of Chrome and everything. You need to support Windows 10. So you need to develop in the code in order to keep your malware running on those recent Windows versions. So you had to pay somebody. What he has added, so yeah, it's mostly supporting more browsers, supporting Windows 10. He pays somebody to support .bit domains. So it's domains where you need specific DNS to reserve them. Fun story, I saw him. So Zeus is used to deploy WebInject. And he has some trouble with the WebInject because lots of the victim, they didn't have any security product, but the WebInject were blocked inside the browser. And it's in fact because those victims were using adblocks, and the WebInject CNC were on the adblock list. So the CNC was blocked and the WebInject wasn't working, which is kind of fun to think about adblock as an anti-bank fraud product, but actually it was working. So he developed a little module in Zeus to auto whitelist himself into the whitelist of adblocks. And after that, there is no problem anymore. And he pays somebody to retrieve the VNC source code of Caperb and modify a little bit everything to make it work. I saw him discussing that whole operation with Deus Pony and what he was hosting around. He's saying it was with the Fallout Fallout guy they were discussing, and Bagzu said that operation runs over 10 years and he pay around $100,000 for everything, like development, hosting, and everything. It's around $100,000 over 10 years, which seems a lot, but actually it's not a lot. It's $10,000 investment by month, and that guy fraud millions, so it's really not a big deal. But it's still interesting to see the kind of cost they can have. So $100,000 over 10 years for this operation. As I said, Zeus is here to prompt your WebInject. So WebInject, it's Zeus is gonna infect your computer, inject code inside your web browser, and that malicious code is gonna check what website you're visiting. And if you're visiting your bank website, that little malicious code is gonna inject some code inside your bank website in order to steal your credential when you type them. They're gonna steal your credential. Since 2014, yeah, I've observed more than 700 different German banks URL, which is huge, because compared to the German bank market, it's huge. But that means the guy followed year after year, month after month. Sometimes the website they changed, they had new designs, or small bank part of a big bank open, so you need to have to cover that website and things like this. And for all these web injects, we know that Bagzu is not developing them himself. It's a huge work to do. It's a full-time job to do web inject. And on the cybercrime market, you have two big web inject sellers. It's like the most famous web inject sellers. One is called Marseille, and the other guy is called Yumba. You have different other guys doing web inject, but those two are the biggest one. And we know that Bagzu was paying Marseille to develop the web inject. And that probably cost him a lot of money. Those web inject developers, it's also a very interesting business because those people are specialized into making realistic copy of websites. So they do web inject, but they also do phishing kits and stuff like that. And they are very good at it. And it costs a lot of money. So it's also an interesting business. So to resume, Bagzu was around. He was spreading Pony to steal your credential, like if you need an email, RDP, like Amazon or eBay account, if you need to fraud some packages. So he steal your credential, he inject your browser with Zeus, he install VNC on your computer, because to commit a fraud, you cannot just steal the bank credential of somebody, go to your computer, connect on the bank of the victim, and order a bank transfer. That doesn't work like that. Because you have lots of heuristic when you log in inside your bank account. And if you are not using your usual browser, usual IP, usual Windows version, things like that, when you're gonna try to steal the money, flags are gonna be raised somewhere and your bank transfer are gonna be stopped. So what they do, they use Deus to deploy web VNC module. So they can connect through VNC to the victim and use the real computer of the victim to connect to the bank account. Like this, there is no flag raised anywhere. But that's still not enough to steal money even in 2018-19. So now you have two-factor authentication everywhere. And in some countries, you have different forms of two-factor authentication. The most famous are SMS. You have different other way of doing it. Some countries, they use a software on your computer you have to run. So if you use VNC, that doesn't really protect you because you're on VNC, you just run the two-factor authentication software and you can bypass everything. But Bagzu was using an Android banking trojan. How you move from Windows to Android, it's pretty easy. So he has the web inject. So when you connect to your bank account and you're infected by this action, the Bagzu guy will prompt on your screen, on the bank website screen, an alert saying, we have a new security app. And if you want to use your online banking website, you need to install this application. So you have three ways of installing the application. We can send you an SMS. You can scan a QR code on the website. Or they even explain how to use ADB. So you plug the phone by USB on the computer, and they explain how to install the APK. That doesn't seem very advanced, but actually it works pretty well. And you can see on the right, the screenshot of the SMS. It really looks like a bank SMS. And when you're doing online banking, you say, I want to receive an APK. You receive this kind of link. The domain looks like a German bank. Somebody can be easily fooled if you're not into security and anything. It's very easy to be fooled. And that technique was working very well. And for each different victim, he was building a specific APK, so it's easier to track. That was very well done. So to resume, so he was again using Pony, Zeus, stealing the credential, using VNC, deploying Android when you need the two-factor authentication, and he was committing a fraud. But in 2018-19, that's a very complicated operation because that takes a lot of time to maintain everything. You need to maintain your server, you need to update your banking program that costs money, you need to update VNC, the Android part. It's kind of hard, and it costs a lot of time and money. I think for Baidu, it's more a manner of costing time than money. But that operation was very, it was dying. Baidu has to do something because if he wants to continue to make money, this kind of infrastructure was not good for the future. So I was still following that guy. I observed Baidu one day. He came on Jabber and he was discussing with somebody who was selling VNC access. Because you have sellers of VNC, it's a big business, very interesting business. Because you can just buy a VNC, you can buy a list of VNCs access without any banking program or anything. You just buy a list of VNC, you connect, you drop the keylogger via VNC, and you can easily retrieve a banking credential, and you have everything to just throw the bank directly from the VNC. It's a big underestimate market. VNC is super big, and those people make a lot of money. So he was discussing with a VNC broker. Baidu starts saying, oh, I have to do some change on my infrastructure. But you will see something big is coming. Trust me, you're not going to regret this. Something big is coming. So when I saw this, I was very interested. So I start looking around what big Baidu can do. And I found this screenshot on that website where he was leaking everything. So it's a screenshot from his virtual machine infrastructure because Baidu, it's a very serious guy. I really like the way that guy is working. He's very serious. He knows what he's doing. He knows a lot about Windows and stuff. And he was testing all his banking trojan and build and everything were tested in many different Windows VM with different KB, different browser, different things like this. That allow him to make sure that the malware is not going to crash during the operation. So I found this screenshot from his VM system, and when you look at this screenshot, so it's Wireshark, and on Wireshark you can see a web request. You can see an HTTP request. And some DNS request. And when you work on the banking trojan industry, you quickly recognize those requests, and it's clearly a GOSI request. So that means that GOSI is actually Baidu is actually looking into GOSI, and he starts using GOSI. And that's interesting because GOSI is close to what we can call a banker as a service. So Baidu is not paying for any development or anything. He just paid the GOSI group. They give him back a malware, a panel, and he do everything himself. So that's a very interesting move that I've tried to follow. I can see I have a question. Can Baidu web inject? Yeah, so the question is like, because in Denmark, for the two-factor authentication, we use an app. It's not SMS, it's an application. I think it's the government who developed it. So we have like a physical card with number on it, and the two-factor authentication is physical. And this kind of Android malware cannot bypass NameID two-factor authentication like this. But he cannot, for the only reason, it's because Baidu doesn't work in Denmark, and in Germany they don't use this kind of system. But if Baidu have to work in Denmark, for example, for NameID, we have a NameID application. So NameID is the two-factor authentication we have in Denmark. Some people have a NameID application. So if you have access to the Android phone, he can do something around the name ID application and bypass the two-factor authentication. So here, that will not work. But it's only because Daxo is not targeting Denmark. Don't hesitate to ask questions. If you have questions, I'm going to try to answer them. So as I was saying, Daxo was moving to Gozi. So that's pretty interesting. He seems to move to what we can call Banker as a Service. And after digging, I finally understand that Gozi version Daxo was moving to, it's Gozi we call DreamBot. So it's a bot that appeared in 2016. It's based on ISFB, so a malware that leaked in the wild. Around 2015-16, DreamBot appeared. DreamBot died in 2020. Daxo was, in my opinion, the last big client of DreamBot before DreamBot died. And after observing his CNCs, I saw he managed to do around 600,000 infections between October 2018 and August 19, which is a lot compared to what he was doing with Zeus. And I start seeing that actually he was not targeting only Germany. He was targeting Germany, but also Canada, the US, Poland, even India and Japan. And when I saw that, for me, it was kind of a mystery because why Daxo would do that? Because he's focused on Germany. But I've continued to dig. And by digging more, I also found out that Daxo was also paying TrickBot. And he died for 20,000 infections in Germany, so that time was only Germany. And each time you saw in the wild the DreamBot, the TrickBot, GTAG, GBA, or TRG, it was Daxo that was buying to TrickBot some infection, and TrickBot was infecting people for him. Because that's how TrickBot works. TrickBot, you call them and you say, I want 1,000 infections in that country, and you pay TrickBot, and they're going to give you the number of infection you need. And that's why Daxo has done. He just invests money into DreamBot and TrickBot, and he get back infection. After digging more, I also observed that Daxo was actually a client of Emotet. It's super interesting because Emotet is so very trendy these days. But it's super interesting to see that he managed to have access to this kind of botnet, and he was using Emotet to distribute DreamBot and TrickBot in Germany, Poland, Italy, and Japan. And why Daxo was doing this is because Daxo, he's a carder, so it's a guy frauding the bank, but he also understands that to make more money, something very trendy to make money on the internet these days, is to resell bots. It's called load selling. So what Daxo was doing, he was, for any reason, he has a good feeling with Emotet. So he managed to use Emotet to distribute DreamBot around the world. And DreamBot was used to deploy WebInject. But those WebInject was not his own WebInject. Somebody else was paying him to host their WebInject, and Daxo was distributing for them. That's the business we call load reselling. And that's how the cybercrime industry. I'm going to try to explain better because it's a big mess, and that's why it's very hard to do threat intelligence around these big buttons. I still have a question. I'm going to go for it just a little bit after this to not get lost. This is the Daxo DreamBot CNC. So you can see what's happened. You can see you have a configuration and task. Each time the Daxo spread a new campaign with DreamBot, each campaign will have what they call a group ID. So he can split the botnet in different group ID, and he can resell this group ID to different other partners. So you can see the group ID 130, it was somebody working in Canada. So it's not Daxo frauding the bank himself. He just distributes DreamBot to somebody else that works in Canada. Because that guy in Canada, maybe he don't want to manage his own botnet, he just wants bank credential and BNC, so he pays Daxo for doing it. It's very interesting to see because there is a lot of kind of conspiracy theory behind the banking Trojan. When you saw these guys frauding thousands and thousands of bots, you think that it's very easy to get rich by banking Trojan, but actually it's super hard. And when you look at the CNC, for example, the DreamBot CNC, you can see that they check manually every single bot, and they look if the bot have money, how, what kind of money, what they can do, if it's, I don't know, a POS, is that a guy, an accountant, is that a guy on Amazon, maybe we can fraud Amazon. So it's a very long job, and you have to hire people, because when you do 600,000 infections in a few months, you cannot check manually the bot yourself. You have to pay a partner to do this. Every banking Trojan operation do that, they pay. It's never a guy alone, it's a group of people working together, and they split the job, like one guy by bank, or one guy specialized in Amazon, one guy specialized in eBay, one guy in, by bank. It's a very long job, very, that works well, but still it's a very long job. That was his TrickBot CNC, so you can see basically he paid. He always had access to a pool of 20,000-25,000 bots, German bots with bank. So every day he can just connect on his CNC and look for a new bot that like he wants to fraud and make money with it. I've looked around on social media if I managed to find information about Daxo. And it's very, it's amusing because you can see, for example, this tweet from Seth Boone. So they were mentioning Emotet and TrickBot using an application to bypass two-factor authentication. But, and it was attributed to Emotet or TrickBot. But the reality is that it was Bagzu, just he was using Emotet and TrickBot, but at the very, very end, it was Bagzu on his web inject, and he was using the fake app to fraud the bank. So Emotet and TrickBot was just kind of distributor to, for that specific operation. I also found that Vitaly was mentioning like not much people were following the fact that Emotet was also dropping DreamBot, and not everybody was focused on TrickBot and not and nothing else. But Emotet also distributed other stuff, and he was distributing DreamBot in Germany, and it was again Bagzu. So like two different tweets on different malware, but at the end it's the same guy behind. And also amusing, I found so that tweet, and it's from Japan. And it's somebody again complaining that Emotet is distributing DreamBot in Japan. So you can see Germany, Japan, that doesn't make any sense. But actually, at the end, it's the same guy ordering, giving the order behind, and it's the same guy managing all the stuff. So it's very, very hard to understand the thread intel behind. I'm already late on the time. I'm going to go quick. I'm sorry. So quickly to recap, so as you can see, the bag, it's very dense and everything is interconnected. The Bagzu guy is the guy paying Emotet to spread DreamBot and TrickBot in Japan, Poland, Italy, Germany. And actually he spread to infect people with DreamBot, TrickBot. DreamBot, TrickBot, they're gonna prompt web inject. And those web injects, it's actually other people web inject that pay Bagzu at the end. Because the people, they don't want to deal with distributing a malware, managing a botnet, they just want the bank credential. So they pay Bagzu for doing this. And Bagzu at the same time, he's still a carder, so he still fraud the bank. So he's also a carder. He's a guy distributing a different malware, but also frauding the bank. And it's something very, very, very common, because when you when we looked at, for example, the guy paying Bagzu for Japanese web inject, we saw that guy, he was also paying Ramnit. He was also paying Zeus Panda, he was also paying Danabot to spread those web objects. So that it's somebody who wants bank credential, he just pay everybody in the market that have a botnet because he don't want to deal with his own and he just pay them. So it's very, very complicated, it's very dense, and when you do thread intelligence, it's very hard because our industry, we like to do attribution based on the tools because we like attributing stuff to Emotet or DreamBot. But at the end, you can see that doesn't make any sense if you don't attribute to a carder at the end. And it's very hard to do this attribution. Today, I can see what's going on because Bagzu make a huge mistake. Without that mistake, I will never understand anything. So it's very, very complex. What is the most interesting in that story to, for me, it's stealing bank credentials, stealing your credential, infecting people with a malware. It's kind of super easy. It's not technically huge. You just pay the right people, they do the job for you. What's interesting is how you launder the money you steal. stealing money from a bank account, it's easy. You connect, you order a bank account, but you need to order a bank transfer. But you need to make sure that nobody can find you. You need to make sure that the bank will not block your transfer. So it's a big challenge, and that's where kind of all the fun is. And Baxo is very, very smart, and he knows very well the German market. And we observed three different ways of fraudulent money. The first one was to steal a package from Amazon. The second one was to pay a money mule as a service. And the third one was his own money mule business. I'm going to start with the money mule as a service. So it's very easy. Baxo, he hacked somebody in Germany. Let's say he hacked a company in Germany. He can order a transfer 20,000 euro he can steal. But he needs a money mule to send the money somewhere. He doesn't have any money mule around him, so he just go to a forum and he say, I need a mule in Germany right now. It's like right now, somebody can reply to me. And you have some people replying, say, I have this, you can send this amount of money, and I take, I don't know, 10%, and I give you the rest. And we observed that he was working with a guy called Mech, and lots of other people. But he was working with a guy called Mech, and it's a funny guy, so he's focused on specific payment system like Giropay or Sofort or Netware in Germany. It's some specific payment system for paying fast, having fast payment. That's something Solector, they love that. So he was just discussing with Mech, and one day they have, like, he was laundering money for Baxo. And when I was looking at the money stolen from the bank account, I noticed that Mech was saying, like, I'm using Colombian bank, work with me. And Baxo was actually sending money, like, it's here, it's almost 10,000 euro, sent to Medellin, to a fake company in Medellin. So it's this kind of traces you can see. He worked with this kind of stuff. And they just go on Jabber or any forum and they say, I need a mule now, somebody's going to reply. Because money mule as a service is really a thing on the internet. It's a huge thing on the internet today. Very interesting stuff that Baxo was also doing. So he was paying somebody, and for every victim that had Amazon or eBay credential, he was paying somebody to fraud them. So it's not that easy to fraud an Amazon account, because you cannot go on anybody Amazon account, order stuff, and deliver to Ukraine or Russia. Amazon will block the order because you have lots of red flags. So what they were doing, they were using the VNC, again, to go on the computer, go on Amazon, and they use a service, so it's a money, package money mule as a service. Again, everything is as a service on the cybercrime. So you go on VNC to a victim, you connect on his Amazon account, and you cannot send the package too far away from where the victim is used to order. So what they do, they use a website that have a huge list of money-muge package money-muge, people they have hired, that live all around Europe and the world. So let's say you want to fraud somebody in Berlin that have an Amazon account. You're going to go to that website and look for a mule, money-mule, that's living in Berlin near that victim. And you're going to go to Amazon and order a package and send the package to that victim that live in a few streets from your victims. Like this for Amazon, it's not really suspicious. It's the classic area, and they do that. And basically, you have to send a lot of packages to those services, and Baxo was sending a lot of packages. Each time, for each packages he was sending from Amazon, he was earning between 10 to 50% of the price of the packaging. So you have to send a lot of iPhone and computer and graphic card and stuff. But Sam, this is very, very trendy. It's something that works very well. That service was called Stuffer. It's something very, very trendy these days. And the last one was his own money mule network. He was managing his own money mule networks. Basically, he hired some people around mostly Ukraine. So the game was he steal the money in Germany, transfer the money around until managing to transfer the money outside Germany, sending the money to Ukraine. In Ukraine, he has a pool of money mule who has fake company and business credit card. He sends the money to those people. They go to the ATM, take the cash, and end of the story, the money is gone. And yeah, it's very interesting to see how that works. It's sad, but that's very successful. And when you look at the carder, when the carder's frauding, when you look at the amount of money fraud, it's always a good question, like how much that guy made by month. So I was looking around, and those guy, at least Bagzu, he was frauding sometimes 5 grand, sometimes I cannot see a little bit more, 6, sometimes 5 grand, up to 10 grand, sometimes 20. So that can quickly be a lot of money. I also noticed that a lot of those carders, they like calling themselves Robin Hood because they say we steal the West, and actually insurance are paying because the bank are covered by insurance, so nobody's losing money. But that's really bullshit, and they know it's bullshit because when you look on the CNC and the command those people leave on every bot, you can see like on that screenshot, they target somebody, it was a random German citizen. And they managed to see that the guy has his salary at a fixed date, like 27 every month. So they leave a comment, every month, the 27, you have to steal the salary of that guy. And it was just a random guy. You steal the salary to somebody, even if it takes 2 weeks to have the money back by insurance, you put people in lots of trouble, you put people in psychological trouble. So the Robin Hood argument is complete bullshit and doesn't work. It's just something that I like to say to make them feel better when they look at themselves in the mirror, I guess. Also, when you fraud the bank, sometimes you get very lucky and you get access to this kind of bank account with like multi-million euro available, but you cannot transfer 2 million euro to Ukraine. That doesn't work like this. There is no bank in the world that would let you do that. So you have to be creative and think about different ways to steal money little by little. Manage to have the most profit possible from this kind of bank account. So very interesting. And you also sometimes have to do more technical work, for example, for DreamBot. So we observed that somebody was infected by DreamBot in November 2018. Bagzu looked at the bot and he saw, you can see in the command, there is a POS on the networks. We saw there is a POS. The bot was infected in November, and 5 days after the first infection, they dropped the second stage, probably to do something with the POS, and the POS got compromised. So when you do incident response on this kind of case, you have to get back to the first infection of DreamBot, and that can be very, very complicated. Yeah, it's complicated, and it's, at least for incident response, can be a very big nightmare. And they try to do any way possible to steal the money. I've managed to cover one laundering scheme out of the three, so it's the homemade money mule business. I've catched only for a short time between December and March 2019. I've managed to catch different bank transfers, so it's only Germany, it's around 100 fraudulent bank transfers. It's probably a very low estimation because there is no Amazon, and it's only Germany, it's only his own money mule, so it's probably low estimation. But for 3 months of business, it was around 600,000 euro cash out. So not stolen, because when you steal money between the moment you steal the money and between the moment you cash out the money, you can lose the money in the middle, because the bank can stop the transfer. Here I'm speaking about cash out money, like in cash, 3 months, 300,000 US dollar. It's not a lot, but for me it's a lot, because when you look in real life, you have people taking the risk to like rob a gas station with a gun, trying to shoot somebody for a few bucks, and that guy in 3 months can make probably way more than $500,000 US dollar. So it's a very profitable business, as you can see, and those people make a lot of money. And also, fun fact, I've managed to retrieve a screenshot from his wallet, Bitcoin wallet, in November 2018. So he has 18 Bitcoin. So back then it was 4,000 for Bitcoin, so around 70,000 US dollar. Today, if he keeps those Bitcoin, today it's $500,000 US dollar. So even by doing nothing, he just had a good investment. Though this money became very, very big, very, very quickly. I'm going to conclude. So as I've tried to show, the business is very dense, and it's a lot of different products you can buy. And in the security industry, we focus a lot on botnet, phishing, scam. We know a little bit who sells the botnet. We know a little bit, let's say, who are the hoster. That's most of the thing we are doing. But actually, that's very, very small part of the whole business. And the whole business, it's a lot of people, because when you do, let's say you want to spam, you have to pay a spammer. A spammer needs, he needs list of email, he needs credential to send the email, he needs traffic. When you work with an exploit kit is the same, he's gonna need traffic. Sometimes the traffic came from the spammer. So it's all this industry, they work together. And it's kind of very big, and it's a lot of people. And behind one botnet, you can have till 100 people working. If you count everybody, it's almost 100 people working behind all these small companies around. And they just, it's just about, you arrive in the fraud industry, you have money, and let's say I want to spend $50,000 and make profit with, it's like trading kind of, but more technical. And you invest those money in the different product, and at the end you're gonna have something back. So you invest in the botnet, in botnet and everything. Those products are gonna give you back credit card data, online banking credential, they're gonna give you online shop credential. You also will have bots that you have those bots, but you cannot do anything with them. But that has still value. So those bots, for example, you can resell them to somebody else that will have interest to them. So that's money. All those credit card and online banking, they are gonna end up into black markets and stuff like that. Those black markets, they have, they also have to hire people to manage the business. So it's really a whole interconnected industry. Yeah, that's very interesting. And I'm gonna finish here, and just to end up on Baxu. So we observed Baxu using TrimBot and DreamBot. DreamBot died last year, the beginning of the last year. It seems that Baxu killed the botnet, but DreamBot was dying anyway. But we observed Baxu, and he moved today to the ransomware. So he was close to TrickBot. So no surprise, he's today part of the Ryuk nightmare. So he's today client of Ryuk, playing with Ryuk. And you can also find him being an administrator of a very famous black market, a very famous forum, very trendy one. That shows that that guy continued to evolve, and that's the natural evolution of this kind of actor. And he followed the trend of switching to ransomware. That's nice to see, but it's impressive to see that guy coming from Zeus 20 years ago continue to evolve to end up today being one of the admin of a big forum and part of the ransomware nightmare. So very interesting case. I hope I've tried to, I've explained what I've tried to say. It's kind of my first time doing this kind of presentation online, and it's very hard because I don't have any feedbacks. So I hope I've been clear, and I really like that case. So it's kind of hard to explain well. And that's all for me. I'm going to check the question because I saw a bunch of questions. So somebody asked, it's about the name ID things we have, as I was discussing in the beginning. Somebody asked if somebody can be compromised using the name ID. So we already saw that some people can be compromised. For example, so you have banking Trojan, they can use the web inject. And they can ask for the victim to take a screenshot. So I'm not going to show. So I'm not going to show my number. But basically, we have a card like this. And on the other side, you have all your number. Damn, I hope I didn't leak anything. No. So you have lots of number. And the web inject can ask the user, take a screenshot of this card. And that can be enough. If he has access to the Android and the user is using the name ID app, he can probably access to the app and do something. So there is, if you focus really on it, there is a way, but it's very complicated. In Denmark, it must be very complicated and cost a lot of money to fraud only Denmark. Like you have to spend a lot of money to bypass name ID, and I don't think the Danish market is big enough to spend a lot of money to fraud the Danish bank at that level. Different level, that's another story. But I think, so long story short, it's possible because everything is possible, but it's not likely these days. I have to slide using the app, yeah, so maybe the app, it's more complicated. I think that talk has been recorded, so if you want, there will be a video. And I think that's all for me.